I'd like to get us started. Welcome back. For any of you who maybe were looking at the program online and are confused right now, I am not Tracy T. Meyer, our student colleague in theological studies. She unfortunately informed us that she has the flu, and so she conscientiously is staying home today. I'll be filling in and introducing our two panelists this morning. Our first, Daniel Rober, has been up here a couple times already. He has very graciously been filling in for his colleague Michelle Loris, who is unable to be here. But I'm very happy to say he'll be presenting now on his own behalf, his own work. And he has been introduced a couple times already, but for those of you who may be joining us for the first time for this session, he's a faculty member in Catholic Studies at Sacred Heart University in Connecticut. He holds a PhD in systematic theology from Fordham University, as well as a bachelor's from the University of Notre Dame and a master's in theology from the University of Chicago. In 2016, he published Recognizing the Gift Toward a Renewed Theology of Nature and Grace. And his current research focuses on the intersection of Catholic theology and discourses surrounding the secular. His paper is entitled Renewing Christian Humanism, Catholic Higher Education Beyond Anthropocentrism and Technological Anti-Humanism. Please join me in welcoming Daniel to the podium.
Much, and you're going to all be very sick of me by the end of this paper. I hope somebody is be willing to sit next to me at lunch. But I'm tasked now with taking us from the practical back to the theoretical after we abandoned that trajectory. Although my theoretical discussion here will in some ways be intensely practical, because it's about issues that concern us all and concern very practical matters in their own way. So the idea of Christian humanism, the positive appropriation of all that is good in human thought and production by Christians, by Christianity, undergirds many visions of Catholic education, including and especially the Jesuit tradition, as we heard so eloquently yesterday in Jacob's paper. In the mid-20th century, leading up to Vatican II, this humanist vision was named and expressed by a number of key thinkers, including Henri de Lubac, Jacques Maritain, Gabriel Marcel, and John Olin, as well as by Pope Paul VI, who was a friend of Maritain's. Humanism more broadly also became a debated secular thought in this period, particularly between Jean-Paul Sartre and Martin Heidegger, and their famous debate on this topic, with Sartre's Existentialism as Humanism and Heidegger's Letter on Humanism. This humanist vision, however, faded and fractured quickly amid divisions in the church, as well as challenges to various aspects of humanism as a Christian or secular enterprise, particularly through ecological critiques of anthropocentrism, which I will address shortly. In the meantime, since the late 1960s, various new forms of anti-humanism have arisen, spurred on particular by technological developments that have undercut the need for human work and interaction in certain sectors. Yuval Noah Harari's recent book, Homo Deus, has sketched out a vision, somewhat dystopian vision following from these developments. Franklin Foer's World Without Mind has similarly raised questions from a secular perspective about anti-humanism and technology. And I'll be talking about these works and some others within the course of this paper. Certain philosophical trajectories of thought, particularly the work of Michel Foucault and others inspired by it, have contributed to this anti-humanist moment by emphasizing the ways in which human beings are trapped in inescapable power relations. For a kind of good primer on this, I strongly recommend Stefano Skirlanos's An Atheism That Is Not Humanist, Arises in French Thought, a very good kind of sketch of some of these ideas, and with also some allusions to de Lubac. Foucault's Neo-Nietzschean vision has been particularly influential and tends to have more purchase in today's academy than, for example, Steven Pinker's optimistic atheist humanism, which has received a lot of attention recently, but is, I think, not as influential in the academy today. This paper, then, seeks to argue that Catholic higher education ought to be the place for the renewal and redevelopment of a Christian humanist vision that engages with these challenges. I'll be focusing particularly on the technological challenges today. A vibrant defense of Christian humanism is precisely not defensive or reactionary. It is a putting forward of a vision of human flourishing that does not need to be threatening to other creatures or the natural world in the anthropocentric mode that has been rightly critiqued. On the other hand, Christian humanism needs to provide robust arguments in favor of the human, particularly against aspects of contemporary technology and society that threaten it. As a value, the Catholic University ought to be a place where students are enabled to understand and articulate the importance of human dignity and achievement in a special way, a kind of incubator of Christian humanism that can help us to spread this vision within the broader society that I think sorely needs it. I will focus the latter part of my paper then on two aspects of Christian humanism that I think ought to be at the core of our concerns as Catholic educators. The first of these is the dignity of human work, which has been rightly emphasized by Pope Francis and Laudato Si, as well as in other places, yet faces severe challenges from automation and other technological forces. Catholic University curriculum ought to emphasize the good of work beyond its remunerative aspects, along with the idea that there are economic goods that transcend efficiency. The second aspect of Christian humanism that I will highlight is particularly appropriate in today's educational context is its high valuing of reason, not only in terms of the relationship between faith and reason, which is very important, but also reason as offering the possibility of mediating between positions and perspectives. Reason's imperfections have been rightly highlighted in postmodern philosophy, but too often in contemporary society is put aside without being rightly appreciated. I will argue in particular that Christian humanism properly construed corrects the Platonist tradition, which of course has strongly influenced it, by viewing reason as embodied rather than as a dualistic product of our minds that could and might be better off dispensing with our body. And we'll talk about the real threat posed by this. The model of faith and reason in the Christian humanist tradition, which prizes reason while acknowledging its shortcomings, can help prepare students for a world in which cries of fake news often substitute for rational inquiry and investigation. And it can also provide a challenge to the neo-Gnosticism of ideas like the singularity, which otherwise have a kind of romantic, but I think ultimately nihilistic, appeal. So, my first section, Christian Humanism and Anthropocentrism. Jacques Maritain's work, particularly Integral Humanism, first published in 1936, was perhaps the most influential oeuvre of exposition of the renewed Christian humanism. As Joseph Evans puts it in the University of Notre Dame edition of Maritain's work, this book did much of the spade work for Vatican II, also directly influenced Paul VI, Pope Lauren Progressio. Again, Paul VI and Maritain were friends, going back to the 1940s, and Paul VI, Montini's work and the Secretary of State and some things that went on there. In that book, Maritain argues that Western humanism has religious and transcendent sources without which it is incomprehensible to itself. This is kind of the rallying cry for Christian humanism. Henri de Lubac's 1940s work, The Drama of Atheist Humanism, is also influential in its discussion of various 19th century figures. It still influences thinkers like Charles Taylor, who speaks of exclusive humanism. He owes this language basically to de Lubac. Maritain's work, of course, also influenced the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as we heard yesterday. And I would posit that this renewed Christian humanist vision of this period also played a role in the rise of Christian democracy parties in Europe following World War II. This kind of broad Catholic-influenced vision of Christian humanism had a lot of purchase after the war. This idea of Christian humanism, after experiencing something of high point in the 1950s and into the 1960s, essentially in Vatican II, in Gaudium and Spes, you really see this vision also, has receded somewhat in the decades hence. And there are a few reasons, I think, that this has occurred, particularly in the American context. First, as more voices began to be included in the disciplines out of which it emerged, particularly theology, Christian humanism as a concept began, I think, to seem a bit dated. The work of an academy consisting exclusively of white males, with the after effects of Renaissance humanism, right, to which it often referred back, implicated in many of the evils of the early modern era, which linger with us today. The rise of colonialism, religious wars, the slave trade, right, all of these are coming out of the same culture of Renaissance humanism that Christian humanism often looked fondly back to. A humanism coming out of such a limited perspective was discredited as truly representing the human experience. I should note in this context, though, interestingly, one of the things that I came across fairly late in preparing this paper was that one of the fairly pioneer American Catholic women to get a PhD in theology, Sister Agnes Cunningham, wrote a 1968 dissertation on Newman entitled Toward a Theology of Christian Humanism. So I did come across that in this context. I thought that was interesting as a, in this dynamic. The second factor, though, the environmental movement began to expose the tragic shortcomings of humanism in the form of anthropocentrism, an issue on which I'll expand shortly. Third, and from another very different angle than the ones I've just been looking at, the evangelical religious revival in the 1970s United States spurred a critique of humanism from the right that closed off another set of intellectual circles to this idea. So the idea of humanism became kind of a threat in this context. So the former two ideas, the critique of kind of white male, androcentric, racist bases for humanism, these I think are valid. I will address the third, which is I think is more misguided, but still influential, when I come to the discussion of reason at the end of this paper. I just wanted to mention that. It's important in this context to note that even within the Christian tradition, of course, humanism is not the only option. Indeed, there are anti-humanist trajectories within Christianity that have tended to critique human production and its potentialities. A lot of people would associate Luther with this tradition, right, of looking at humanity from a negative perspective of our sinfulness. Some people would try to rope Augustine into this. I would be a little more wary of that, but I certainly see where they're coming from. So there are trajectories within Christianity that are anti-humanist, if not anti-human, right? But that have tended to make this critique. So anthropocentrism is the dark side of humanism, and it has been a very dark side. I'm reminded in this context of Walter Mignolo's very important book, The Darker Side of Western Modernity, which is a great book about critiquing modernity and its values, and particularly using the darker side in two ways to refer both to the darkness of things that were produced by Western modernity, but also the way that darker peoples were often oppressed by it. So it's a really good book in this context to think about. But Maritain, returning to Maritain, he himself speaks of an anthropocentric epoch in early modernity in which humanity starts to take over the terrain once ceded to God. And this goes very well with Charles Taylor's narrative and various other narratives. Christian humanism, however, has not been exempt from this, this problem of anthropocentrism, as Wendell Berry and Lynn White have rightly pointed out. Berry, in particular, tries to take a biblical position that relativizes the human soul. To quote Berry, "We are holy creatures living among other holy creatures in a world that is holy." Lynn White, meanwhile, in his famous famous essay in Science, Historical Roots of Our Ecological Crisis, undertakes a critique of medieval Christian cosmology as dualistic in a way that influenced scientists who themselves often dabbled in theology, such as Newton. Humanism, of whatever sort, can, if not properly placed in a broader planetary and cosmic perspective, cause human beings to view themselves as the center of the universe. When they have done this, as we well know, the consequences have been devastating for the planet, and indeed for many human beings on it. As Elizabeth Johnson puts it, theology has, in these cases, bracketed out nature and made it extrinsic. Critiques of anthropocentrism, then, particularly in light of ecological disaster, have appropriately served as a temper on humanism. Any humanism going forward has to attend to these critiques or risk rightful perception as retrograde or revanchist in substance. This trajectory, then, constitutes one side of the frame we need to draw around humanism. Christian humanism must reject anthropocentrism and come to terms with human relations to the planet and to non-human animals. Nonetheless, I personally do not think it is wise to let go of humanism as such. To see the value of humanism, I think we need to look at another threat to humanism and the human, that posed by technology, particularly in the form of cybernetics and other technologies that seek, often in very explicit language, to fundamentally transform the nature and fabric of human existence. So I turn now to my second section, the challenge of technological anti-humanism. This brings us to the question of contemporary anti-humanism, which is most evident, I think, in the realm of technology. While there are certainly philosophical strains of anti-humanism with significant purchase today, such as Foucault's body of work mentioned above, For most people, it is this technological strain of anti-humanist thought that has and will continue to have the greatest impact on their lives. The anti-humanist tendencies in the rhetoric coming out of many contemporary technology companies are often relatively subtle and available mostly to those who pay close attention to the speeches given by CEOs and others, as well as the kind of research that they are doing and funding. Martin Ford's 2015 book, Rise of the Robots, points out one of the challenges to humanism today, a particularly practical one. The problem is automation and the basic change it is making to the meaning of human labor. Part of this problem is economic, particularly in the United States, with high inequality, and a situation where, in Ford's words, the overwhelming success of those at the extreme top seems to be correlated with diminishing prospects for nearly everyone else. The cycle of recessions and recoveries leads to new jobs being created that are worse than those that were lost before, particularly middle-class jobs. At the same time, automation is beginning to eat away at lower-paying retail jobs and some professional jobs, such that, according to a 2013 study, occupations amounting to nearly half of U.S. total employment may be vulnerable to automation within roughly the next 2 decades. This trend is exacerbated by the increasing specialization of jobs and by the fact that online jobs tend to pay much less and to work in a winner-take-all fashion that produces very few middle-class types of jobs. So a lot of the work that's done is essentially freelancing, with most of the profits going to those who actually own whatever platform the work is on. Notably, for our purposes here at this conference, Ford points out higher education and healthcare as the two notable exceptions to this trend, at least so far. Even some kinds of law, for example, can be automated among the professions. But these two fields, higher education and healthcare, have thus far resisted automation owing to their nature and the personal interactions on which they depend, or at least have depended to this moment. In fact, as Ford notes, the growth in administrative positions means that higher education, in his words, has seemingly become a self-perpetuating job machine for the highly credentialed. Unless, that is, you actually want a job teaching. Massive open online courses, or MOOCs, which initially seemed the advanced front of technological trends in higher education, have stalled somewhat due to high dropout and failure rates and other factors, but cannot yet be discounted as a threat, according to Ford's analysis. Despite the many other challenging trends that face us in higher education, we currently occupy a bit of a bubble with respect to this one. Again, leaving aside to a certain extent, right, of course, the academic job market, which is not a bubble in terms of this issue, but higher ed as a whole has been relatively healthy in terms of employment levels in other areas. I think this is important to keep in mind as we respond to it. Ford's frightening endgame would be one in which the global economic system adapts to this new paradigm, such that, as he says, the mass market industries that currently power our economy would be replaced by new industries producing high-value products and services geared exclusively towards a super-wealthy elite. This trend is already evident, as certain kinds of retail stores, once viewed as mass market, such as toys, to name one that has recently been in the news, now tend to be the province of upper-middle to upper-class communities. Right? So I think of, for example, when I was at the American Academy of Religion in Boston, I was staying in a hotel in the South End, a very wealthy, nice community, and there was this beautiful little neighborhood toy store there, which you contrast, meanwhile, to Toys R Us, the mass market version of this, going out of business. So this is kind of an explication of this phenomenon. So this is what Ford is showing us, that economic trends are going against full employment and certainly against kind of middle-class kinds of jobs. And not only that, but even services cater to such people. So I want to shift from Ford to Yuval Harari. Yuval Noah Harari is an Israeli historian. And he's laid out in his book, Homo Deus, the clearest and I think most chilling vision of the implications of contemporary technology for humanism. So Ford tends to take an economic perspective. Harari is taking an anthropological perspective. His previous book, Sapiens, was about evolution. So here he's looking at Homo Deus as the next phase of evolution. According to Harari, the challenge is not so much replacements by robots or an AI revolt. Rather, Homo sapiens is likely to upgrade itself step by step, merging with robots and computers as a process, until our descendants will look back and realize they are no longer the kind of animal that wrote the Bible, built the Great Wall of China, and laughed at Charlie Chaplin's jokes. While such change will be gradual, according to Harari, the pace of technological change is fast. He says, our world of meaning might collapse within decades. You cannot count on death to save you from becoming completely irrelevant. Again, he's rather blunt in his language. And he says, these developments are likely to change the world beyond recognition this century. There's a twofold problem here that Harari raises. Harari presents his book very much in terms of cold realism. In other words, I'm here to give the reader a cold shower in terms of what's going on. He's very detached from the moral implications of this. Twofold problem here. It's very difficult to stop this chain reaction. And, as Harari puts it, if we somehow succeeded in hitting the brakes, which would be extremely difficult, our economy will collapse, along with our society, given that the modern economy needs growth to survive, and the growth of Homo sapiens is the ultimate growth initiative, according to Harari. Harari is deliberately provocative, but the problems he raises are foundational anthropological issues. What does it mean to be a human being? And how do we as humans fit into the future that we as a species are in the process of creating? For him, religious humanism is not really sensible. As he argues it, humanism's triumph was precisely the triumph of liberal ideals over religious ideals. So for Harari, humanism is essentially something like Pinker's ideal, right? Of liberal humanism, reason replacing religion as the arbiter of human affairs. But the triumph of humanism is now going beyond itself, pushing humankind to reach for immortality, bliss, and divinity. Not for the masses, but certainly for Silicon Valley executives and those like them. The triumph of liberalism for Harari was not an altruistic victory. Rather, he says, it took place because there was an abundant political, economic, and military sense in ascribing value to every human being. So it made sense, it worked. In today's context, however, as Harari puts it, intelligence is decoupling from consciousness, such that now intelligence is mandatory, but consciousness is optional. As a result, it is increasingly easy to replace humans with computer algorithms that are more reliable than humans. In the reality that is coming, people will become accustomed to seeing themselves as a collection of biochemical mechanisms that is constantly monitored and guided by a network of electronic algorithms that know us better than we know ourselves. And he thinks the moment that they know us better than we know ourselves is the moment when it's all over, essentially. The political and philosophical implications of the situation are that liberalism will collapse on the day the system knows me better than I know myself. That's his argument. Harari's is a dark vision of a kind of technological soft totalitarianism, such that the individual is more likely to disintegrate gently, in his words, from within than to be brutally crushed from without. Medicine will thus become less about helping the sick than about upgrading the healthy, to give an example. His narrative repeats key elements of Ford's narrative that I sketched out before, but in a much more radical, and in my eyes, bleak way, owing to its scientific and evolutionary thrust. For Harari, the trend of technology is anti-humanist and literally anti-human. And we need to reconcile ourselves to that future because it is inescapable. Much like Foucault's genealogies lead to the conclusion that we are shaped by power relations with little way out, except in his later work, through practices that help us to detach ourselves from them in certain ways and to form ourselves. Harari's future offers little for the average person, but much for the elite. So I want to close this session with just discussing another work, which is kind of responding to both of these trends, and then take it back to how we as Catholic educators can respond to this. So journalist Franklin Foer, his book, World Without Mind, aims to challenge precisely the kind of vision put forward by Harari. Foer is particularly concerned about Google, when he calls its attempt to create a superior species, a species that transcends our natural form. The problem here, beyond the project itself, as he describes, is that it's turned the liberation of the brain into an engineering challenge, an exercise that often fails to ask basic questions about the human implications of the project. So he's talking about the idea to collect all knowledge, and to release knowledge from things like copyrights and all this. Forelus refers particularly to emphasis on the singularity as a kind of theological conviction that Google and other companies seek to impose on the world. Forelus is also concerned about how in different ways Facebook and Amazon devalue knowledge, damaging both informal and formal ways in which knowledge is traditionally controlled and dismantled. This has a positive effect in some sectors, but important negative consequences in others, as we've seen in recent election cycles and the state of news and how people view it. So Forrest's diagnosis, and again, I'm moving a little quickly through his work here because I want to get to the conclusion, but his proposal is similar diagnosis to Harari's, but his proposal is different. Rather than resigning himself to the death of humanism, he calls for a paper rebellion, in which we must abandon the technological revolution to save the revolution of freedom that accompanied it but now sits in tension with it. As Forrest puts it, the proliferation of falsehood and conspiracy through social media, the dissipation of our common basis for fact, is creating conditions ripe for authoritarianism. The merger of machine and man, machine and human, as Ford puts it, now threatens the individual, so that human nature is at risk of a fundamental change, which Ford does not view itself as the problem. Rather, he puts it, we might decide to sail happily past that threshold of changing human nature, but we need to be honest about the costs. As opposed to the current situation, which he views as drifting without countervailing pressure towards an acceptance of monopoly and conformism on the part of tech firms. What the three authors detailed above clearly describe, and others such as Jaron Lanier and Douglas Rushkoff have also detailed in different respects, is a situation in which the epistemological foundations of traditional humanism are under severe threat as a result of big technology. These are trends from which we as educators have certainly not been isolated, and which increasingly pervade our campuses. The question to which I'd like to turn, then, are how we ought to respond as Catholic educators. What distinctive contribution can Catholic education make toward dealing with these issues? So, my next section, the path forward for Catholic education, where I'll try to sketch out just a couple of ideas. The above challenges may tempt us to lose hope, to feeling that we are helpless to thwart the forces that challenge our students and our own livelihoods. This, of course, is precisely what we as Catholic educators cannot do. And I'd like to point to two areas in which we need to highlight this for our students and for ourselves. The first area that I'd like to emphasize is the dignity of human work. The Protestant work ethic and its place in American society certainly emphasize work as a value, but they have not always properly emphasized its dignity in relation to our human nature. For many, work is a necessity, but one that takes away rather than adds dignity to their lives. And work often is a drudgery for many people. Exploitative wages, poor working conditions, sexual harassment, and other related issues have been endemic to the world of work for much of humanity, not only in our society, but for much of history. Emphasizing the dignity of work, then, does not simply mean also repeating old truisms of Catholic social teaching that go back to Leo XIII and the Industrial Revolution, as helpful as these are. There must be a development of doctrine in Catholic social teaching to adjust to these realities. Pope Francis has made a start on this, particularly in Laudato Si, but more needs to be done. As Francis puts it, we were created with a vocation to work. The goal should not be that technological progress increasingly replace human work, for this would be detrimental to humanity. Work is a necessity, part of the meaning of life on this earth, a path to growth, human development, and personal fulfillment. This is an important statement from Laudato Si, but against the enormity of what we were facing, I fear that it is underdeveloped, and in fact something of an assertion, essentially. So I'd just like to allude briefly here to, I need to sketch this out a bit more, but to Joseph Pieper's famous work, Leisure, the Basis of Culture, a work of that kind of great period of Christian humanism from the 1930s to the 1950s. Right, and in that work, Pieper strongly emphasized the idea that leisure is an important part of human existence, and one that's made possible the cultivation of the self. The greater opening to leisure by certain forms of automation has to be considered an important human good. It's a positive that people have time to engage with the world around them, rather than be engaged constantly in difficult work. Leisure, of course, though, raises other problems and can beget certain vices, but this is not an insoluble issue. But the question, however, that has to be addressed by a new Christian humanism and by Catholic social teaching, I think, is the prospect of leisure or some facsimile thereof without work. Pieper's vision of leisure presupposed a backdrop of work for most people. Some, of course, unacknowledged by pay, right, as women's traditional housework in a lot of societies has been, right, much domestic labor, right. But we need to reevaluate this context of work against which much leisure made sense. How do we redefine our notions of leisure and of what it means to be a human being called to work when work itself becomes increasingly scarce? With the rise of automation and the coming automation of important industries such as trucking, taxi cabs, other forms of for-hire transportation, and fast food, just to name a few, the developed world faces the prospect of mass unemployment on a scale that may be difficult to imagine, based on prior precedent. This problem demands of Catholic social teaching a serious consideration of the question of universal basic income and what that might entail. And I've seen very little of this to this point. Much of Catholic social teaching on labor has been concerned with working conditions and the dignity of those who are working. But less energy has been paid to the question of the need for work or income, period, precisely because this connection has been a relatively unquestioned functional norm of human life and history, that to get income, you work. To examine this point, I turned my attention to the Compendium of the Social Doctrine of the Church, which again, I'm not going to quote you what I found there, it's very much the same idea as what we just heard from Laudato Si. The discussion of full employment as a mandatory objective for every economic system oriented toward justice and the common good. Again, this is a very nice statement, but I think there's a lot that needs to be done to engage with the reality we're entering into, where that statement seems very almost naive. A society in which the right to work is thwarted or systematically denied, and in which economic policies do not allow workers to reach satisfactory levels of employment, cannot be justified from an ethical point of view, nor can society attain social peace, according to this document. But as that norm collapses, new work needs to be done. This ought to be an important task for Catholic universities, both to incubate this research, but also to model how a life-giving vision of work might take shape in a new situation. So our labor practices at universities ought to model what are we proposing. This is an extremely challenging task because it runs up against the logic of capitalism, which of course is growth, and in this case, growth means less money for people, more money for corporations. As Martin Ford describes it, for a people-oriented system to be economically competitive, it either has to be significantly less expensive than the automated alternative, or produce results so superior that they deliver substantially greater value to customers, and ultimately generate enough additional revenue to make these extra costs appear to be a rational investment. Intentional humanism, in other words, what Catholic social teaching as it stands for would suggest, based on the documents I just quoted, is a bad business proposition. This is why Ford, among others, argues for a guaranteed income system that would contain incentives to work but would at the same time encourage productive economic risk and entrepreneurship among those who otherwise might have been more conservative with their money for fear of ruination. I am not here to solve this problem, so much as to suggest that it is a pressing one for Catholic universities to engage thoroughly and inform their students about, since many of them view themselves as training for jobs that may not exist in a few years, and ought to be equipped to think about what ought to happen in that eventuality, not only for themselves, but for society, for the world. Catholic universities, then, ought to be models of the dignity and meaning of work, as well as the limits to which it should be the source of all our flourishing. And an economic and scientific climate that rapidly seem to eclipse the human, Catholic institutions must be leaders, not followers. They do not simply exist to staff this new situation or to assist in its rise, but to raise difficult questions and to form leaders prepared to offer protest or alternative visions when necessary. The second major point that needs to be emphasized by Catholic universities, which again is not a new one, is to advocate for the place of reason in human discourse. Like Christian humanism, reason has had its reputation damaged somewhat with the exposure of the power structures that lay behind much traditional rational discourse. This critique is important and must be internalized by anyone who advocates for reason. But it is not the final word. If we are trapped in power relations and unable to say anything meaningfully objective from a rational perspective, this vitiates our ability to argue in common and leads to the continuation of our fake news culture that technology is embedded in, as Ford describes, which is undercutting democratic institutions around the world, not least in our own country. To speak of reason, however, is precisely to speak of embodied reason, and this is where we must push back against the world that Harari describes. While Harari's vision of the human future is one that continues to assume the possession of a body in some form, it is a dualistic vision in which that body has been subordinated to the mind, and possibly to other minds, such as those of artificial intelligence. The relentless project of innovation and growth that this mentality flows out of is a vision of self-transcendence, but a distinctly less hopeful one than that of traditional religious visions. This, I think, is the Gnosticism of which the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith speaks in its recent document, Placuit Deo, which came out a few weeks ago, describing a new Gnosticism. This document raises the issue of a vision which, quote, presumes to liberate the human person from the body and from the material universe, in which traces of the provident hand of the Creator are no longer found, but only reality deprived of meaning, far into the fundamental identity of the person, and easily manipulated by the interests of human beings. I view this as the ultimate problem of information and algorithms as discussed above. They are manifestations of disembodied reason that exemplify in a new way what Charles Taylor has described in another context as excarnation. In the face of these challenges, it is the task of a renewed Christian humanism to say that such a vision does not comport properly with either Christian faith or with human flourishing. Nor does it comport with the flourishing of the broader created world, as there is no guarantee or reason to believe that a transhuman or post-human future would be more ecologically sustainable than the human present. A new vision of reason, then, would not simply have the task of asserting that reason is important, helpful as this might be in some respects. Its job, rather, is to explain what kind of reason is important and why. Reason is important as an expression of our full humanity, including our embodiments, precisely in that it does not completely encompass our humanity, our reason, that is. Like Christian humanism, this reason must go beyond its rooting in white male hegemony. But on the other hand, it ought not to go completely beyond or against the human. This would be an abuse of reason, and one which I argue only embeds our society's detachment from reason. So the singularity and ideas like it, I think, are rival theologies to that proposed by Christianity. And these are things we ought to oppose, and oppose, and I think, more vociferously than other secular ideologies which many theologians have dedicated themselves to critiquing. Given the existential threats such trends pose, in Fore's words and Harari's effective description, such challenges ought to be at the center of our concerns. In a climate where the threat of nuclear annihilation has received renewed attention, rightfully, the softer threats coming at us through our screens and our computers, and particularly to the companies that produce them, ought to be of concern precisely because they are less obviously horrifying and more alluring, precisely because of the convenience they offer us in the meantime. Brief conclusion, in the ruins of humanism. We stand then in the ruins, I think, of traditional humanism. This is clear to us in our university context, where the very idea of the humanities often comes under attack precisely in the name of education for science and technology, typically with an emphasis on the latter. In this context, I think it's more important than ever to defend humanism promoted by the humanities. And I think this is precisely why retreat does not make sense, right? So there's a lot of attention paid in certain intellectual circles to ideas like the Benedict option, right? A sort of opting out of the society, which is clearly headed in some frightening directions. But I think the project of promoting Christian humanism is an evangelical project, in that this ought to be a vision of the human person that is put forward for everyone. And it's precisely a vision that takes risks. A quasi-monastic preservation of culture following a catastrophe is one thing. One that refuses to deal with an impending catastrophe is another, rather less impressive thing, in my opinion. And I think that's our situation. Neither will putting forward the traditional vision of Christian humanism as articulated from the 1930s to 1950s be adequate to serve us going forward. Again, I'm happy to quote Pieper and Maritain, I do, but I think that those ideas are helpful. This is a more engaged vision than the one I described above, the Benedict option, it still possesses some serious problems, right? Maritain and the others in this period have much to offer us, but they do not have all the resources we need to deal with these challenges. Rather, we need a Christian humanist vision that is fully awoken to the perils of anthropocentric humanism and to the failings of its own traditions, both in the form of the church as well as in intellectual traditions that too often have given cover or themselves propose various forms of elitism and exclusion. So the task of forming a new humanism, a new Christian humanism, is the task, I think, of the Catholic University of the 21st century. And it is a challenge that I hope that we are able to rise to for our sake and for the sake of humanity. Thank you.
Our next presenter is Dr. Scott Roniger, who is an assistant professor of philosophy here at Loyola Marymount University. He studied philosophy and theology in Rome, where he earned a baccalaureate in sacred theology with a minor in philosophy in 2009, and an MA in sacred theology in 2010, both from the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas. He then pursued graduate studies at the University of Chicago, earned an MA in philosophy in 2012, and then returned to Rome, where he earned a licentiate in philosophy at the Pontifical University of the Holy Cross. He defended his doctoral dissertation in the School of Philosophy at the Catholic University of America in fall 2017. He has published articles on Aristotle, Augustine, and Thomas Aquinas, and has a forthcoming article on the relationship between law and virtue. He'll be presenting this morning on The Essentials of a Catholic University, Truth and Sacramental Presence.
While that's being passed around, I want to thank my colleague, Brilliant Trainer. I want to thank all of the staff at ACTI for this conference, for letting me be a part of this conference, which gave me a great opportunity to reflect on the nature of the Catholic University, but also just generally for all the work they do throughout the year. The ACTI, it's a wonderful presence on campus. I always tell Brian that I wish I could contribute and participate in more of the events. I go to as many as I can. So I just want to start by saying thank you. The handout, as you'll see, has three hand-drawn figures because I always try to make a rule to have as few machines as possible come between me and my interlocutor, so you should be happy. So there are three diagrams, right? And the three diagrams will correspond to the three sections of the paper. The description of this conference includes the following question. What is the essence of the Catholic University today? I wish to begin by making three points, two as an initial response to this question, and one concerning the nature of the question itself. First, I wish to claim that the essence of the Catholic University is the same today as it was in the 11th and 12th centuries when the first universities grew out of cathedral and monastic schools in Europe. While the instantiations of this essence have changed, both by way of addition and mutation, while our collective understanding of the essence of the Catholic University has waxed and waned over the centuries, the essence itself of the Catholic University is, and will remain, identical across time and space. To ask the question, what is the essence of the Catholic University today, is to ask, what is the essence of the Catholic University? Second, to inquire about the essence of the Catholic University is, at the same time, to inquire about the essence of the university simpliciter. Both in the order of history and nature, the university is a peculiarly Catholic reality, and we would do well to remember this fact today, living as we do in an age and in a culture so bent on deracinating itself. We should avoid the temptation of thinking of a Catholic university as an oddity or outlier in the contemporary world of higher education. One could indeed argue that what makes a Catholic university distinctive today, provided, of course, that it remains true to its nature, is that it is the only kind of university that is fully a university. A truly Catholic university is a university in the fullest sense of the word. It most fully realizes the end, or telos, of the university itself, and, as Aristotle tells us, the end, or telos, of an entity is its nature activated as most fully itself. Third, we should pause and reflect upon the nature of the question. What is the essence of a Catholic university? This question is a most peculiar one, and, as are all questions of the same kind, and we should allow ourselves to feel the wonderful, even delicious, peculiarity of such a question. The activity of asking What the essence of an entity is signals that we have entered into a very unique perspective. Questions such as, what is the essence of a Catholic university? Or, what is the essence of a human being? Or, what is the essence of food? Signal that we have, in Joseph Pieper's excellent phrase, transcended the everyday world of work, that we have moved beyond what he calls the workaday world. He describes this workaday world as the world of work, the utilitarian world, the world of the useful, open to achievement and subdivided according to functions. It is the world of supply and demand, of hunger and satiety. It is dominated by a single end, the satisfaction of the common need, and it is synonymous with doing things for useful ends. That is, doing things the reason for which lies beyond the activity itself. We must be quick to draw the distinction between the common need and the common good, and to add that the common need does not and cannot exhaust the common good. But I shall speak more of the common good later in this paper. For now, let us make a few strategic distinctions in order to clarify the nature of our question and the nature of the perspective we must adopt if we are to ask and answer all such questions. Following Edmund Husserl, we first distinguish between, one, the natural perspective, which finds its home in correlation to Pieper's workaday world, and two, the philosophical perspective, where questions concerning the essence of an entity find their proper home. Next, we can subdivide the natural perspective into two. The naive, direct focus on objects, whether they are present or absent, that marks our original perspective on the world, and a kind of pre-philosophical reflection on judgments or propositions, in which an agent shifts his focus from the objects spoken about and experienced to particular judgments about those objects by adopting a critical focus toward a particular judgment and measuring the judgment against the object or state of affairs being discussed. This is the first handout. The first diagram will hand up. However, the philosophical perspective is a more fully reflective, detached perspective that contemplates and discusses the necessities, connections, and possibilities within both aspects of the natural attitude. The philosophical perspective enables us to analyze and discuss the subjective activities and their objective correlates precisely as intended by subjective activities and as contemplated from the philosophical. The shifts in focus or perspective that we have discussed, both within the natural attitude, from things to judgments about things, and from the natural to the philosophical attitude, can be illuminated by an example. Let us imagine two gentlemen, recalling that gentlemen can be said in many ways, walking along the promenade on a spectacular Los Angeles day. Let us randomly call one Dan and the other Martin. And let us imagine Dan and Martin engrossed in conversation as they saunter along the ocean's shore. They are speaking of their friendship, of their shared taste in music and art, of their families, of the weather, and, since they're in LA, of the route they took to arrive at this beautiful beachfront destination. The subject turns to movies, and they discuss plans to see that classic of Italian neorealismo cinema, Roma, Città Aperta. They settle on a day and time, and then they begin to discuss the film itself. Dan tells Martin that the film was set in Indiana in the year 1954 and uses a basketball team to tell a great David versus Goliath story. Martin hears Dan's words and recognizes that this description of the film is strange and incorrect. Dan's depiction of the film jars with what Martin knows to be true about neorealismo. Dan's statements conflict with the character of such films, and this discrepancy prompts Martin to adopt a new perspective in his conversation with Dan. He no longer simply lives through Dan's words and focuses on the reality those words articulate, but rather he turns his attention to Dan's judgments themselves and measures those judgments against the reality they are meant to illuminate. Martin therefore adopts something of a reflective attitude towards Dan's statements, in order to confirm or deny them. In this case, his reflective assessment of Dan's statements shows that Dan is mistaken. He simply doesn't know what he is talking about, however rare such an occurrence may in fact be. These movements of human intelligence are marvelous in their subtlety, and they texture our approach to reality and to each other when we are operating within the natural perspective. In the first part of their conversation, both Martin and Dan operated within the naive, object-focused dimension of the natural attitude. But But when Dan uttered strange statements about a particular movie, Martin moved into propositional reflection. However, this reflection itself is nested within the natural attitude, and therefore, in all of these movements of intelligence, neither Martin nor Dan entered into philosophy. Will they ever do so? We might wonder. However, imagine that two people, let us call them Aaron and Jeffrey, were sitting on a nearby bench and overheard this conversation. Reflect, and also Brad and Brian. Let's imagine people with those names over there. reflecting on what they saw and heard, Aaron asks Jeffrey, but what is the essence of a film? What makes a film to be a film? After discussing this question, Jeffrey asks, but how are words correlated with the being of things? How does a word present a thing in its presence or its absence? And how is the thing being spoken about the same across its presence and absence to the speakers? Aaron and Jeffrey and their friends are operating from within the philosophical perspective. They have transcended the natural attitude, and as philosophers, they cannot be practically involved in Dan and Martin's conversation because, as Cicero says, philosophy lies in a new dimension. Thus, the philosopher, from his or her position as a disinterested onlooker, sits on the sidelines and looks at what has taken place in the natural attitude. He can distinguish between the two aspects of the natural attitude, the naive object-centered awareness and the reflection on specific judgments carried out in propositional reflection. Husserl helps us see that the natural attitude and the sciences it sustains take the possibility of knowledge for granted. The philosophical attitude, on the other hand, does not. As the phenomenology of knowledge, it reflects on the relationship between knowledge and its object. Its aim is to reveal the essence of knowledge. Now, knowledge is essentially knowledge of objectivity. Dan and Martin were pursuing a particular truth, but Aaron and Jeffrey were free to ask, quid est veritas? Only from this philosophical perspective can we ask and attempt to answer a question such as, what is the essence of the universe? Because this perspective enables us to pursue truth in a comprehensive way using a language troped from the natural attitude. We've been contemplating the nature of our question using the distinctions between the natural attitude with its dual dimensions and the philosophical attitude, and we have discussed the shift into philosophical thinking. In doing so, we have also come upon something very important about the nature of the university itself. The university is a place where truth is sought for its own sake and from a unique perspective. The questions we have highlighted are best asked, and their answers are best explored within the university, which provides the proper setting to induce the turn to such questions and to sustain the erotic search for their answers, even though all such answers can never be final. Therefore, getting clear about the nature of these questions and the perspective from which they can be presented and pursued is also to get clear on an important dimension of the university itself. The community that is the university not only enables and encourages philosophical questions, it also provides the framework that allows us to pursue these questions in a scholarly and systematic way. The university is a programmatic extension of the philosophical attitude. As a community, it is the concrete social form that institutionalizes, in a healthy way, the disinterested love of truth. And I don't think that's a contradiction to say disinterested love. Aaron and Jeffrey can raise and discuss philosophical questions by the beach, but they can best live the philosophical life within a university, which is in the workaday world, but not of that. Before moving to the next section, I want to add one further nuance. The university is a community in which all kinds and layers of truth are sought in conversation across the disciplines, which means that the university contains scholars operating in both the natural and philosophical attitudes. Philosophy crowns the liberal arts and requires the turn to the philosophical perspective, but as Husserl saw clearly, the so-called hard sciences operate within the natural attitude. The methods used in these sciences are exquisitely refined forms of thinking within the natural attitude, but these sciences, by definition, do not look to the whole of things. They section off a part of being, but they do not see the whole of things, nor do they see the part in its relation to the whole, at at least not qua scientists. To recognize this point is not to disparage or denigrate the hard sciences or their practitioners, but to recognize their intrinsic limitation. Catholic thinking at its best need not denigrate one thing in order to exalt another. However, by being placed within the university, these sciences participate in a mode of pursuing truth for its own sake. Sciences pursued in a university must have a different character than those same sciences pursued in a military or commercial laboratory. Even obviously the methods would be the same. The inclusion of the sciences in a university curriculum liberalizes them to a certain degree. They still operate in the natural attitude, and they still investigate only a portion of being. But in a university, such knowledge should be pursued first and foremost as an end in and of itself. Something like Newman's understanding of what philosophical thinking is, which is not what we think of the discipline of philosophy. It's more having a cultivated, perfected intellect where your mind is sharp, you can see connections, you can ask the right kinds of questions, and you can connect things to each other. That's kind of philosophical thinking at its best. And I think within a university, the sciences, they're sort of formed that way. Participate in that kind of thinking. Okay, next section. We've now cleared the ground so that we have the space within which we can seek a fuller answer to our question. What is the essence of a Catholic university? But to continue our progress, we need to make two important distinctions. This is the second diagram. First, we must distinguish between the essentials and the accidentals of a given reality. For example, if we were to search for the essence of a human person, we would have to see that there are many accidental features of any given individual person, and that these accidentals are not essential to being a person. Someone's height, weight, skin color, eye color, or preference for neorealismo or French New Wave cinema are accidental features. But having an animated body is not accidental to being a human person. Being an embodied creature is essential to being a human person. However, after distinguishing essentials from accidentals, we must also subdivide the essentials of an entity. Within the essentials, we can distinguish the essence itself from the per se properties of that entity. In the case of a human person, we can identify per se properties, such as the ability to speak and the ability to laugh. But these properties, as essential as they are not yet the essence itself of a human person. In the ontological side, the essence itself of a human person is to be a rational animal, an individual substance of a rational nature. In the ontological order, the properties of a person flow from the essence itself. We can speak and laugh because we are rational and not vice versa. So, how is this ontological structure of accidentals, essential properties, and the essence itself realized in the case of the Catholic University? Again, we should note that the distinctions we have just made in the search for the proper understanding of the essence itself is a philosophical activity. First, we can identify the accidentals of a Catholic University, such as the number of students, the geographical location, whether it is a Jesuit, Franciscan, or Dominican university, although there may be people who have a problem with saying those are accidental, but we'll leave that to the side. To say these features are accidental does not mean they're unimportant, but it is to recognize that these features, as crucial as they are, do not make the university to be a university. As we move to the essential properties, we can identify the crafting of scholarly writing, the advancement of culture, and the presence of a rich sacramental life on campus as per se attributes or properties of a Catholic university. But scholarly publications, the administering of sacraments, and social beneficence do not the university make. So, what is the essence itself of a Catholic university? I wish to suggest that the following definition captures the essence itself of a Catholic university, or at least it begins to. A Catholic university is a scholarly community devoted to the study, that is, the teaching and learning, of universal knowledge for its own sake. It is the community of scholars and students who pursue universal truth for its own sake and also put all knowledge, human and divine, at the service of Jesus Christ. This definition of a university places the teacher-student relationship at the very core of the university. The unified teach-learn activity done in a scholarly, systematic, and universal manner is the essence itself, as distinct from the essential properties. The university exists, it most fully activates and expresses itself in the scholarly teaching of students, and such teaching must not be limited to a few disciplines or to the students' principal interests. It must be a universal teaching of all knowledge, at least as far as possible, and this knowledge must be sought both for its own sake and for the sake of a better knowledge, love, and service of Christ. Let me ward off some possible objections or difficulties before developing certain features of this definition. First, searching for knowledge for its own sake does not mean that we do not recognize or desire the practical benefits of a university education. It is rather to see that knowledge for its own sake is an intrinsic good because it is a perfection of the human intellect. The intellectual virtues are goods in and of themselves, and the enjoyment of truth they make possible is to be sought for its own sake, not for the sake of some extrinsic benefit it may bring. However, we know and embrace the fact that certain kinds of knowledge make one capable of a given career. We know that certain sciences can relieve human need and succor human misery. And this very welcome aspect of knowledge is given its due place in a university. Augustine says that some goods are only to be used, some are only to be enjoyed, God, and some are to be both used and enjoyed. Clearly, many kinds of knowledge and intellectual virtue should be both enjoyed and used. But the university community aims at the target of perfecting the intellect for its own sake. That is its telos and reason for being. Second, if all knowledge and intellectual activity is to be placed at the loving and intelligent service of Christ, have we not excluded non-Catholic or at least non-Christian faculty and students? We have not. The Catholic university demands not that one be an active believer, but that one be open to an honest and disinterested engagement with the truth of divine revelation as it is passed on by the church, and that one cultivate an appreciation for the harmony between reason, operating under its own natural exigencies, and reason as it is perfected by faith. What is required is an openness to contributing to a scholarly community in which universal knowledge, including the knowledge that is communicated via faith and studied in theology, is loved and taught for its own sake. The third and last objection I'll take up concerns the relationship between the essence itself of a Catholic university, as I have described it, and the publication of scholarly articles, books, or creative works. These activities are essential to the life of a university, but they are not of the essence itself. Scholarly publications flow from and return to a professor's teaching. They are born from the demands of scholarly teaching, and they buttress such teaching. Additionally, insofar as scholarly publications contribute to teaching a broader audience of students and peers beyond the walls of one's own university, they come very close to the essence itself of university life. Just as language flows from and perfects rational life, so too scholarship flows from and perfects the teaching that is the essence itself of the university. To conclude this section, I wish to say a few more words concerning the role of sacramental life in a Catholic university. By claiming that a robust sacramental presence is a per se property of the Catholic university, I am attempting to navigate something of a middle course between St. Bonaventure and Cardinal John Henry Newman. Newman claimed that moral education and training fell outside of the university's purview, while Bonaventure argued that there is a moral dimension embedded in learning, and therefore in the university itself. And he argued further that this moral dimension would determine to a large extent how far one could progress up the ladder of knowledge. By locating the sacraments as per se properties, we can hold on to the insights of both thinkers, at least that's what I hope. With Newman, we can claim that sacraments and the moral life in Christ they engender are not of the essence itself of the university. But with Bonaventure, we can see the essential link between the new life in Christ generated by the sacraments and the journey to God through the various stages of human and divine life. Okay, it's the last section. In the final section of this talk, I wish to deepen our reflection on the essence itself of a Catholic university by discussing in more detail the decisive noun in our definition, community. If the Catholic university is a scholarly community, then we would do well to discuss the nature of communities, as this will shed light on the nature of the university. In order to illuminate the nature of a community, we will, surprise, surprise, draw some fundamental distinctions. In Thomas Aquinas's Social Ontology, any community is a multitude, but it is a multitude that is unified in the shared pursuit of a common good. Communities manifest what he calls a unity of order, which is midway between the substantial unity enjoyed by an individual living organism, such as a dog, and the total absence of unity that can be seen in a heap, such as a pile of bricks strewn upon a sidewalk. The community is unified. It is one thing, but it is only unified in common actions undertaken to achieve and enjoy a common end. The harmony between the parts of the community in view of the common end is analogous to the soul of the individual organism. To see this point more clearly, let us focus on this notion of common good. To quote Augustine, a true common good is one that is not lessened in the sharing of it. A good is truly common when it is not diminished, but rather intensified, enhanced, and enlarged in the sharing of it. It's a kind of wondrous thing when you think about it. On Aquinas' view, we must distinguish between two forms of common good in order to understand a community. The intrinsic common good of the group and the extrinsic common good. The intrinsic common good is the order itself, the harmony itself, that exists amongst the parts of the whole in view of the end jointly pursued. The very order to a common good is itself a common good according to Aquinas. It is not lessened but intensified when it is shared by more members. I mean, just being a part of a group that's harmoniously ordered, just participating in that, is itself a common good of Aquinas' view. The extrinsic common good is also truly common. It is intensified when it is activated and shared. Crucial for Aquinas is the fact that the intrinsic common good exists for the sake of the extrinsic common good. The multitude is unified because they seek a common good that is, in some sense, extrinsic to the group. Let's illustrate the two common goods and their relationship with an example. Imagine a basketball team, let's say, again, randomly, the 2008-2009 team called AD Master Roma Basket, random. The extrinsic common good of the team is victory. When the team won many games, the victory itself was not lessened or parceled out by being shared. Rather, the movements of the players, the decisions of the coach, and the harmony amongst the parts of the organization existed for the sake of victory, but this harmony itself was also a common good that was intensified as it was shared. This comes straight out of Aristotle's Metaphysics in Book 12. There, his example is the army. So, how does this structure of intrinsic and extrinsic common good manifest itself in the community that is the Catholic University? The extrinsic common good that is to be shared is universal truth, and it is the reason for the intrinsic common good that is scholarly intellectual friendship. I wish to claim, therefore, that the soul of the Catholic University is scholarly intellectual friendship, developed and exercised in view of the exploration of truth in all its dimensions. Such common goods, the intrinsic common good of intellectual friendship and the extrinsic common good of universal truth, animate the life of a university and are intensified as they are shared by more members, both faculty and students. Scholarly, intellectual friendship is the soul of this place, and its perfection is the loving, shared embrace of the truth in all its forms, scientific, mathematical, artistic, literary, historical, philosophical, and theological. The soul of a Catholic university is love, and its perfection is truth. We could say that a university is an institutionalized love of truth. And like all true loves, it is fecund. And it is fecund precisely in its teaching function. I wish to quote Augustine once again. In addition to showing the wondrous nature of a common good, that it is increased when it's shared, he also shows us the being, how the being or nature of a common good contains in some way the proper way we should interact with it. He tells us, everything that is not lessened by being imparted is not, if it be possessed without being communicated, possessed as it ought to be possessed. Truth is not possessed as it ought to be if it is not imparted to others, because of its being as a common good. So we see in the very nature of truth a confirmation of the fact that teaching is of the essence itself of a university. Because a university exists to pursue truth, it exists to teach. As always, the being of a thing tells us how to conduct ourselves in relation to it. Is implies ought. Ought is in relation to being. But have we been specific enough concerning the nature of truth that animates a Catholic university? After all, don't all universities pursue truth? We can better understand the nature of truth pursued by a Catholic university by identifying four marks of such truth. Just as the Church herself is characterized by four features that express her nature and mission, so too the Church's universities pursue truth that can be characterized as unam, sanctam, catholicum, and apostolicum. One holy Catholic and apostolic, even though you'd have to put unum to make it agree with very open this one. We will briefly describe how the truth is marked by each of these characteristics. One, the truth is one. This certainly does not mean that the truth is monolithic, nor does it imply a parochial outlook on truth and its possessors. Rather, truth is a unified hierarchy precisely because being is a unified hierarchy. The human mind exists in correlation with objective beings. We reach truth in the intellect's adequating and assimilating grasp of being. As Aquinas says, the mind assimilates the forms of things, and thereby is adequated to them. But the mind is related especially to order. Each realm of being exhibits a kind of order that attracts and captivates the mind. Animate beings can be studied and the science of biology developed because the enlivened bodies of living things exhibit a kind of order, a kind of intelligibility. Chemistry can be developed and taught because of the order apparent in matter and chemical reactions. Each particular science deals with a particular realm of ordered being, but we should also draw on Bonaventure's doctrine that the sciences themselves exhibit a kind of natural hierarchical order. It is not only that sciences study the various foci of order. In addition, Bonaventure argues that these sciences themselves are ordered. Each kind of science, just as each kind of being, functions as a vestige of God's creative act, and therefore points beyond itself to higher and higher kinds of human knowledge. Philosophy crowns the sciences in the liberal arts, but philosophy is also the handmaiden to the queen of all the sciences, theology. Bonaventure argues that theology is surpassed by mystical union with the triune God in this life, and by the beatific vision in the next, but the key is that the sciences, and thus the truth pursued by the university community as a whole, are one because they constitute a unified hierarchy culminating in the systematic study of God's revelation to us in the God-man, Jesus Christ. Holy. The Church is holy. Yes, it is, but the truth is holy. To be holy means to be set apart from debasing attachments, from the brambles of sin and pride, and therefore to be free for union with God. The truth pursued by a Catholic university is holy because it is, as we said, pursued and handed on in the service of the God who is and who creates the cosmos, adequation to which enables us to enjoy truth. Further, the highest sciences are holy because they enable us to know and to taste, to be united in some way to the Godhead. Catholic. The truth pursued by a Catholic university is Catholic because it is universal, which means both according to the whole of things and in keeping with the whole of things. I think you actually need to have both senses of the university. The Catholic university pursues the universal truth. It speaks about the whole of things, both philosophically and theologically, and it sees all of the particular sciences in relation to the whole. Just as the hard sciences are liberalized by their inclusion in the university, So too all sciences, including philosophy, are catholicized by their being pursued in light of God's revelation and theological reflection. Of course, such catholicizing does not vitiate the nature, method, or expertise of the other disciplines, but it does shed light on how those disciplines are situated in relation to the whole and to the one who creates and sustains the whole. Apostolic. The truth is apostolic, both in the sense that we have learned our various sciences because we have entered a living, growing, and organically developing tradition, and because the truth, that we, as we have discussed, is by its nature meant to be shared with all people, Catholic, Protestant, Jew, Muslim, Hindu, agnostic, and atheist, all people. In closing this paper, I would like to make a comment on the words of Christ. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus is questioned by a scholar of the law who asks, "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" In his response, Jesus recapitulates Israel's great prayer, the Shema, but Jesus fulfills the prayer in a way that should capture our attention. The commandment, as it is written in the Jewish scriptures, says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone," or "the Lord is one. Therefore, you shall love the Lord your God with your whole heart, and with your whole being, and with your whole strength." But in his recapitulation of this commandment prayer, prompted by the scholar's question, Jesus says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." Jesus fulfills the Old Testament commandment in the communal life of prayer it animates, in part by explicitly adding the mind. The Lord our God is to be loved with all our mind. What better place to do that than in the university? As with all things, and in all things Catholic, the Catholic University exists because of the words of the Word and the grace that Word offers to us poor souls. Thank you.
Normally we would allow a couple minutes for our speakers to respond to one another, but I am conscious of time, and so I will now open the floor to any questions, comments, observations.
Well, thank you both for your papers. I'm Donna Tiedemann from Seattle University, and I teach theology, Catholic theology specifically. I have an observation in relation to Dan's paper. So I was interested in your focus on humanism. And in the conclusion, you were proposing that a renewed humanism would be a way forward. And I do agree with what you're trying to go beyond there, anthropocentrism, and also technological humanism. But one thing that I thought was missing is maybe a fuller sense of a global humanism. And I don't mean like some flat now, but really with an attentiveness to the variety of cultures, even within Catholicism itself. So I'm thinking that, especially if you even look demographically at Christianity in the world today, the shift is dramatic to the global south. So, I mean, I think in terms of how we imagine humanism in Catholic universities, the standard has been more, like, when you were in the person of, you were playing the part of Michelle yesterday, right, without running that course, I was thinking about how it would be good to incorporate a wider variety of voices that would still be very true to Catholic, into the Catholic intellectual tradition, and even Catholic humanism. It would be a fuller representation of that, is what I've been thinking. So that's just my observation.
Thank you, Donna. Let me just speak to the portion of it particularly pertinent to my paper. You know, I was going to preface the paper by saying that, you know, one of the things I agree with a point in Jacob's paper yesterday about how Catholic universities ought to embrace looking at big questions, and I tend to like to do that and to throw a lot of things in. So this, I was aware of this paper already being, you know, dealing with a lot of issues. but a future iteration of this project that would have more looking at the broader picture of what a renewed humanism would look like. You're correct. I think that would be essential to attend to. In this particular paper, because I was especially concerned with these technological issues, and really both sets of issues, which are very kind of, yes, first world concerns in a lot of ways, but they're also global concerns in the sense that these are phenomena coming out of the first world, so-called, right, that have enormous implications for people throughout the world and for their lives, whether or not they are fully aware or invested in them. So I think there is, in that sense, by implication, a need to attend to these things because they are a certain kind of crisis. But I do agree with you that, yes, a bigger version of this project would need to attend to those things, and I would fully intend to do that.
Just to kind of follow up on Donna's question and frame it a little differently,
yeah.
One of the things I've heard you say is that it's important to talk about that reason as embodied, and use that notion of embodiment frequently. And you talk about going beyond white male hegemony.
Yeah.
And I was really curious as to what that looked like for you, because I was looking for the spaces where there would be that moving beyond. And sort of dovetailing to the second paper around sort of the human being as rational being, there's almost a sense of a desire to be embodied and yet continuing to be disembodied, and wondering about those of us who are differently embodied and how we fit into this conversation and the way it's been moving for the last really day and a half.
Once again, this is a very good question, and in some ways, it's one that will, come out for me certainly in a lot of the sort of detailing of this project. But I think a lot of this is, again, for me, attending to voices, attending to, in the doing of this project, right? So this paper was a fairly broad, in some ways, lay of the land about what needs to be done, but in the doing of it, and again, this is where I think someone like Mignolo is very helpful for us at kind of laying out what have been the boundaries of humanism as traditionally constituted, and trying to go beyond those. So yes, to look at how reason as embodied, right, is very different from reason as, one of the concerns I have with precisely this kind of excarnation is both in and of itself, but it's the idea of disembodied reason in technology and artificial intelligence and all this, but it's also the question of, who is designing this artificial intelligence, this excarnated reason, and for what? And I think that brings us right back to these questions of, not only disembodied intelligence, but what kind of intelligence being disembodied from what kinds of bodies, and how does that play into how it works? So again, I don't mean to be overly vague here, but I do think you raise a very good set of questions.
Thank you. I'll keep going that way and add two things. So the kind of technocratic paradigm and post-humanism that's kind of like this running through your paper, I find that really intriguing, and I'm so paranoid that when I'm typing my work, and there's always my theological nomenclature or ecclesiastical nomenclature is always misspelled, So I think there's kind of this anti-language, hey, anti-language, they're bleaching out of our discourse or something like that. So that's one thing. But on the excarnation, that is really a tension because, you could be Cartesian and be, that's a disincarnate, an excarnating move, right? The vivisection of, the mind from the body. That was always that dualism. I think now we have a reverse Cartesianism in lots of ways where it's all about the bodies. Now the good news is the bodies need to be about bodies of all kinds in the body of Christ. But there is also an imminent frame, right? So I don't know how, technology and bowing happens is going to attack the imminent frame that's going to bring it out that way, but there's something, again, it's kind of schizophrenia, So, again, I'm just thinking out loud, and your excellent paper, and yours too, Scott, that's a whole different alignment there. Your Thomistic disciplines are recovering a kind of order that the rupture of posthumanism is really exploding. So thank you for both. It's really kind of an interesting pairing of things going on.
So, and I think it's pretty good. And again, I think that, you know, and again, to kind of connect your question to the previous question, right, that attending to embodiedness is a way to resist this sort of different kind of excarnation. You know, because again, we talk a lot in the academy about different kinds of embodiedness and all that. But my sense is that, you know, in the lab and in the projects that are getting funded by a lot of these technology companies, you know, which themselves, of course, you know, value diversity and everything just as our universities would in terms of hiring all this, but the project that they're engaged in is, I think, very much one of excarnation, of separating out knowledge, and really, you know, what I said in the course of the paper, right, the separation of knowledge from consciousness, right, of knowledge from human embodiedness, so that it can be put on a server, so that it can be put, you know, into cybernetic form, and so that ultimately, you know, as Harari lays out, right, that people, but certain people, and, you know, by and large, certain kind of people can become immortal through cybernetics, through, you know, uploading their brain onto a drive, essentially, into a disembodied situation where they can continue to live, or in a different body. I don't want to get into the specifics of this, but that's, I think it's a big issue.
Can I just say, just to add a comment to this, I mean, the two movements, the one from excarnation, as you say, and then the other, which seems to be a contradictory movement to an obsession with bodies and flesh, I actually think they're one and the same movement in this sense. I mean, I'm going to draw from Pascal, so I'm going to give something to my colleague Martin, who I kind of took a shot at earlier. I get it from Walker Percy, who picks it up from Pascal. To play, you know, Pascal says, Percy picks it up, to attempt to be the angel, meaning to ultimately end up becoming the beast. Right, so in the attempt to be more than what you are by just being disembodied reason, right, angelic in some sense, you end up actually becoming less than what you are. Mm. So in other words, it's the denial of your proper nature, whether it be from motivation to go above or below, ends up causing you to be something you're not.
That's
in
Alan
this case,
Tate. That's Alan Tate as well.
Okay, good, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Contemporary person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, just a comment.
I think we have time for one more. Jennifer, did you?
Yeah, I'm speaking right after lunch. So.
Okay. Kristen?
Yeah, this is for Dr. Roger. You made a lot of the difference between the essence of the thing and the accidental property.
Yeah.
So as you know, if you're talking about an artifact, it doesn't really have the same kind of essence as accidental properties. And it seems to be the case that a university is kind of artifact. It's a creation of human design and such. So how would you respond to that kind of?
Yeah, it's a really good question. I think it's a little more complicated than that. So I would want to look at a university analogously to the way Aristotle looks at a polis, at a political body. And you could say, and Aristotle does use the language of talking about a polis as a kind, as a sort of a creation in this sense, a sort of product, something that we produce via some kind of techne, some craftsmanship. He does use that language sometimes, but I think when he's at his best, he's showing that this is in fact the perfecting of human nature by doing things which are fitting for us within an institutionalized form, with a constitution, with law flowing from it. So in a sense, it's not the distinction between artifact and nature. It's sort of, they come together in an interesting way in political life, right? Because our human nature is perfected precisely by opening up and allowing a certain kind of craftsmanship to perfect human nature. And I think the university is similar, right? So, you know, as you know, I mean, just a table for Aquinas would have no real unity. It would have a kind of accidental unity. But I think the university, I think any community, think of a family, right? It's got more unity than this table does. It's got less unity than a substantial living organism does. But I would want to locate it sort of for, you know, closer to the substantial unity than to the merely accidental unity of a table or a chair, of something which is purely an artifact. Now, you're going to have a lot of artificial things to get the university to go, for sure. But I think it sort of straddles that divide a little bit. That's what I would say.